Hey everyone, welcome back to Chipstock Investor. It's Kasey and Nick.
Kasey was just yelling at me about the applied materials investment and the fact it went down so much at the end of last week.
I do that a lot. Yo.
You do get very excited and very animated, don't you?
I am so excited right now. What we're going to do is we're going to pretend that you've never watched any videos about applied materials or any of the other wafer fab equipment companies. And we're just going to start fresh. Let's talk about applied materials. One of the Fab Five, a wafer fab equipment manufacturer. If you want to make semiconductor chips, you're going to need to go through one of these five companies. They control around 70% of annual wafer fab equipment industry spending.
This is what we often refer to in the semiconductor and electronics manufacturing industry as a critical choke point, but as powerful an oligopoly as the Fab Five are, they are still cyclical industrialist companies. They make very expensive capital equipment, and their customer base is quite small overall, and especially at this point in time when one company you may have heard of, TSMC, Taiwan Semi Manufacturing, is accounting for so much of the wafer fab equipment spend every year because of their advanced facilities that they're building in Taiwan and in Arizona in the southwest United States.
Despite what you've heard or maybe have inferred from some of these earnings reports from the Fab Five, these companies are actually in a new growth cycle. After they emerged from the bear market in 2022 and 2023, they had that initial spurt of recovery in 2024. However, we've been waiting for a surge of growth to come from new fabs all over the world.
Yeah, industry organization semi.org still has an outlook for about a 10% increase in expected WFE spending in 2026. That was supposed to kind of start accelerating actually in late 2025. So what just happened with Applied Materials' outlook for the quarter that will end in October of this year? Because it wasn't very good.
You're going to see a lot of charts from our friends over at Fiscal.ai. They're the sponsor of today's video.
And we use Fiscal.ai to make charts like this one. Here's a look at Applied Materials' quarterly sales over the course of the last decade. Yes, it's a cyclical business, but as you can see from this chart, it's still very much in growth mode. And what has ultimately happened here for Applied Materials with this latest quarterly update and the outlook for the October 2025 quarter is we are hitting a bit of cyclicality and nothing more than that. This is just par for the course for Applied Materials, excluding that nice steady looking up and to the right revenue over the last 4 or 5 years. That actually is the exception, not the norm.
If you want to make cool charts like this one and dig deep into the financials of a company you're researching, check out fiscal.ai. You can get 15% off with our link in the description or here on the page.
Okay, let's first take a look at Applied Materials Q3 fiscal 2025. That's the quarter that actually just finished up. It ended in July. A lot of the business through this last quarter has actually continued to make new all-time highs, especially memory and advanced packaging. Management talked a lot about the growth of their advanced packaging business on the last quarterly update. But even in this latest quarter, you can see the foundry and advanced logic sales as a percentage of revenue started to decelerate and are starting to get, well, as Kasey likes to explain it, lumpy. Well, a bit lumpy.
Here's another look at the broad segments for Applied Materials over the last 12 months. Semiconductor systems, applied global services, and display, all up from this time last year, but still awaiting some sort of growth driver. But now let's talk about the outlook for Q4 fiscal 2025, which will end in October of this year. Instead of looking at sequential growth, we're actually looking at some sequential and year-over-year decline in revenue and earnings per share. Total revenue expected to be around $6.7 billion at the midpoint, and earnings per share at $2.11 at the midpoint.
And what's really concerning about this slide is the semiconductor systems, that's the WFE, the fab equipment, and global services, both in decline, offset just ever so slightly by that display business driven by a new growth cycle for OLED, ultra high definition displays. Right out of the gate on the earnings call, CEO Gary Dickerson was playing defense. Here's a slide with the quote. We're going to focus in on the second paragraph that we have here, with the three main points being blamed on this sequential decline in sales. First is a digestion of fab capacity in China. Nothing new here. That's been going on since late 2024. Second point, also something that we all already knew all about, the large backlog of equipment pending an export license from the U.S. government. No surprise there as well. The U.S. and China not getting along economically speaking right now, and some of AMAT's most advanced equipment can't be sold to those fabs in China. So management is deciding to continue to not factor for any of those export licenses getting approved.
And the third and last thing that was mentioned is a non-linear demand from leading edge customers. And you can read TSMC right there, which is primarily linked to market concentration and fab timing. Even this third point that management brought out should not be surprising to us. Intel and Samsung Foundry are an absolute mess right now, leaving basically just TSMC as the lone leading edge logic and foundry customer for all of the Fab Five right now. So why would Applied Materials experience such a decline in sales if TSMC is spending so much money?
Yeah, really fair point. And the CFO, Bryce Hill, on the earnings call during the Q&A section, indeed indicated that this leading-edge logic and foundry customer, primarily TSMC, has led to some significant growth in parts of the business. $5 billion in sales for gate-all-around related equipment purchases in 2025 was originally the expectation. It's been lowered to something more like $4.5 billion, so 80% growth instead of 100% year-over-year growth for that part of the business. If you're unclear on what gate-all-around transistors are, check out our video from earlier this year about the next 15 years of logic chip development. We've got that linked here in the video and in the description below as well. Anyways, so this part of the business from advanced logic and advanced foundry is growing. So what just happened? I think we need to come up with an easier comparison here to visualize what exactly is happening to Applied Materials.
I think it's time for a food illustration. Let's imagine that you own a hamburger restaurant and you know it's going to be a really busy day and you're expecting about 100 people coming for lunch and each person wants a burger. You're going to be flipping patties like crazy that afternoon, getting those 100 burgers out to those 100 customers.
Basically, your cash register is going to log linear revenue growth that day because of that line out the door. Now imagine on a different day, you're still expecting to sell about 100 burgers, but you have one big customer you expect to account for most of that demand. So you're still going to be flipping patties like crazy that day, but you're not going to have a line of customers out the door. In fact, you may even have some downtime as you get that big giant order ready, and especially if that one big customer has any sort of delay whatsoever in ultimately coming for pickup of the order. And your cash register is going to have some downtime, aka non-linear financial growth.
This is an oversimplified way of explaining what's happening for Applied Materials forecast in Q4 fiscal 2025. TSMC still wants all of that equipment for their fabs, for gate all around and other manufacturing processes, but they've delayed the shipments for a quarter or two.
Now, let's break it down here another way on this outlook. Here's a look at the numbers again. The revenue guidance implies as much as negative 12% year over year, adjusted earnings per share as much as negative 18% year over year. However, at the absolute high end of this guidance, applied management actually still is anticipating perhaps closer to just a flat line year over year for revenue and adjusted earnings per share. This is not a guaranteed terrible quarter. And part of this can be explained by the fact that things like memory, HBM used in AI servers, advanced packaging, a bit of that display business are actually still doing quite well and perhaps could offset some of the non-linearity in sales to TSMC and that gate all around transition. Here's a look at the free cash flow and GAAP unadjusted earnings per share. It's gotten actually just like we're expecting now for this next quarter that ends in October, some flattish results over the last few years and quite a bit of a roller coaster here. Similar on a free cash flow per share basis, just a lot of high rate of variability in actual cash flows. Remember, a lot of this has to do with, in addition to gearing up for what we still hope will be a bigger inflection point of growth in the not too distant future, Applied Materials has been investing pretty heavily in the business. Things like the EPIC Center in Silicon Valley, this big collaborative R&D space for the industry to work in and for Applied Materials to develop what their wafer fab and chip packaging customers actually need. All of that costs money. So ultimately, even if we do get a bit of a dip in revenue and profitability this quarter, if you kind of read below just the revenue chart that we showed you earlier from fiscal, you can see there's actually been quite a bit of cyclicality already in the business the last few years during the bear market and during this period where we kind of wait for that bigger spurt of growth from the semiconductor manufacturing industry.
All of this can't change the fact that the stock did drop after earnings. So what should we do about Applied Materials? Spoiler, here at Chipstock Investor, our thesis remains unchanged. But let's pretend that we've been upset by this earnings report. Let's talk about a few more financials and figure out whether Applied Materials can or cannot weather the storm. First, let's take a high-level look at their cash flows. And management has continued to stick to the plan to return up to 100% of their free cash flow in the form of small dividends and stock repurchases. Over the last 12 months, they've done exactly that, which ultimately means that they have the room to continue investing in research and development, and they still have spare cash to award owners of the business like us.
And then second high-level look here at the balance sheet. $8.3 billion in cash and equivalents, $815 million in shorter-term investments, nearly $3 billion in long-term investments, including equity stakes in companies like Kokusai Electric in Japan. Compare that to debt of just $6.3 billion. So twice as much cash and investments as debt. This is what some might call a fortress balance sheet. Pair that with the cash flow statement that Kasey just showed you. Applied Materials hasn't saddled itself with financial burdens that it can't control. This very much looks like a cash flow statement and balance sheet of a company that is finding plenty of productive places to put capital in anticipation of long-term investment returns.
Hopefully that helped with your analysis of Applied Materials and some of the other companies in the Fab Five. We use a basket approach when investing in these companies for the wafer fab equipment space. Check out Semiconductor Insider, where you get access to all of our research on a daily basis.
Check it out. We also have weekly live events over on Discord as part of that. And within the next couple of months, we have some exciting new things that we'll announce over there on Semi Insider. Check it out. We've been told it's a pretty unbelievable value.
Take care, everybody, and we'll see you again soon at Chipstock Investor.